I'm Marie Coy in Singapore, the headline. President Trump says he'll impose steep import tariffs on steel and aluminium in a move likely to provoke a backlash from China. Boko Haram strikes again, kidnapping more than 100 schoolgirls in Nigeria. Now nearly a fortnight on, eyewitness accounts start to emerge.
I'm Kasia Madeira in London, also in this program. One of Russia's new generation of nuclear weapons unveiled by President Putin. He says they can evade US missile defense systems. And hoping for Oscar glory, the profoundly deaf six-year-old will be joining the stars on the red carpet this weekend.
Live from our studios in Singapore and London. This is BBC World News. It's Newsday.
Good morning. It's 9 a.m. here in Singapore, 1 a.m. in London, and 8 p.m. in Washington, where President Trump said it's unfair trade as he announced the U.S. will impose tough tariffs on steel and aluminium imports next week, up to 25% on steel and 10% on aluminium goods. In the response, the EU says the move appears blatantly protectionist. Canada, the biggest exporter of steel to the US, called it unacceptable. And China, the main target of the tariff, said they would retaliate. Nick Bryan has the details from Washington.
The derelict steel mills of America's old industrial heartland provided a seedbed for the rise of Donald Trump. He wouldn't have won the presidency had it not been for the support he received from the Rust Belt. The promise he gave to protect U.S. manufacturers from cheap imports, even if it meant sparking a global trade war, echoed through these empty plants. During his first year in office, he didn't erect the kind of protectionist barriers he'd promised. But today came his most controversial trade move yet. Meeting with industry leaders, he announced big tariffs on foreign steel and aluminium.
What's been allowed to go on for decades is disgraceful. It's disgraceful. And when it comes to a time when our country can't make aluminum and steel, and somebody said it before, and I will tell you, you almost don't have much of a country. Because without steel and aluminum, your country's not the same.
Chinese steel only accounts for a small proportion of U.S. imports, but the massive expansion of its industry has produced a global glut, driving down prices, which has angered the president.
Mr. Donald J. Trump!
Much of his America First rhetoric has been directed against Beijing.
We can't continue to allow China to rape our country, and that's what they're doing. It's the greatest theft in the history of the world.
There's already been a fierce international reaction. The European Commission warning tonight of countermeasures in response to what it called a blatant intervention to protect U.S. industry. On Capitol Hill, too, raised eyebrows from senior Republicans, free traders who have long believed liberalized global commerce is good for the American economy. Fears of a trade war helped trigger a large sell-off on Wall Street.
Donald Trump is invoking a Cold War-era measure not used since the Reagan years, which allows U.S. presidents to impose tariffs in the interests of national security. But the fear is it could spark a 21st century global trade war, which damages every economy. Nick Bryant, BBC News, Washington.
Well, let's look at the reaction to this announcement by President Trump. Chris Buckler is in our Washington studio for us. Chris, we heard from Speaker Paul Ryan that he hopes the president would consider unintended consequences on other industries. So is it at all possible that President Trump said this, but he might not actually go ahead with imposing tariffs?
The details of this, frankly, are still to be worked out. And at a White House briefing today, it was very clear that they haven't got those details sewn up. One of the big questions is whether there will be exemptions for some countries. But you've also got to look at the fact that Donald Trump's path to the presidency was paved with these messages of America First, that he talked about the steel workers, the declining industry in America that he was determined to protect. So it seems clear that although there are arguments still going on about the White House and two very separate camps about what exactly should be done here, it seems like he has run out of patience, and there were some caught a little off guard today by this announcement. In fact, the announcement itself was delayed as aides were huddled in corners behind closed doors, having conversations about what exactly would be said. However, Donald Trump is clear. He says that there's going to be a 25% tariff on steel, 10% on aluminium. That's what he intends to put in place. Working out the details now and how that works, that now becomes an issue for the aides and advisers as well as he himself.
Because, of course, critics would say that this would just start a new trade war. And the last time the U.S. imposed steel tariffs was in 2002, and President George W. Bush had to lift them pretty much less than 2 years later because of the concerns. But we heard from Canada, Europe, and, of course, China. But is it possible that these tariffs are practically aimed at China, and therefore all the other bigger exporters of steel could be exempt from these tariffs?
Well, it comes down to Donald Trump's message again, doesn't it? The president is very clear. He wants to be tough on trade and tough on China. So there's no doubt that China is one of the big targets for this. Saying that, exactly how you put in place these exemptions and how it will work, there are other countries that have been caught off guard by this, and you are right to make reference to what Canada, the European Union and China have all said. They've all said that they will retaliate if this goes ahead. That is a concern about a trade war coming. And bizarrely, as this was all happening, Chinese officials representing trade interests were actually inside the White House having conversations with officials there. Now, that was described as a frank but constructive conversation about fair and reciprocal trade. I imagine it was pretty frank, given that this announcement was kind of sprung on them, and those concerns will clearly be about what this will do for trade. Business as well, it's worth reflecting just the stock market as well. The Dow Jones down 1.7% as a result of this announcement. Certainly it was a factor within that, because businesses here are concerned as well. You've got to remember that the US imports much more steel than it actually exports. It needs steel for business here. Industry needs it to keep on building, to keep on working. And as a result, there is a concern about what these tariffs could do. It could raise costs for businesses here in the US, and that's something that businesses are watching very closely.
Chris Buckler in Washington, thank you.
Well, let's take a look at some of the day's other news stories. And all new political parties in Thailand should be able to register from Friday for elections that should be held next year. The Prime Minister, Prayut Chan-o-cha, has promised that they'll be held no later than February, but a date has been promised and postponed several times since the former army chief seized power in May 2014. Mr. Prayut is under increasing pressure at home and abroad to return Thailand to a civilian government. Also making news, it's already been a very dramatic week in the Brexit negotiations. On Friday, we're now expecting another crucial development when the British Prime Minister Theresa May makes a major speech setting out the government's latest position on the UK's future relationship with the European Union. In a meeting on Thursday with the EU Council President Donald Tusk, she repeated the European Union's draft withdrawal treaty as unacceptable. And another Prime Minister has voiced his concern about the process, Tony Blair, echoing calls for a second referendum.
Brexit is momentous and life-changing for Britain. The British people should be given a final say on whatever deal is negotiated. If they are allowed that say, then Brexit can be averted. And I and many others will work passionately for that outcome.
China has reacted angrily to a US Senate bill that encourages closer ties between America and Taiwan. The legislation, which now only needs President Trump's signature to become law, gives the approval for official visits between Washington and Taipei. At the moment, the US restricts this kind of exchange to avoid upsetting Beijing. The North Korean cheerleaders who attended the Winter Olympics are reported to be undergoing re-education following their return home. South Korean media said that the aim is to erase the women's memories of their stay in the far richer South Korea. The Seoul government spent more than $26,000 hosting each cheerleader who stayed at a four-star hotel during their 3 weeks in the South. Billy Graham, the American evangelist who died last week at the age of 99, will be buried later on Friday. Now, his casket left the U.S. Capitol in Washington, where his body has been lying in state. He is only the fourth private citizen to be given this very rare tribute. The funeral will be held in his hometown of Charlotte, North Carolina. By the time that he retired in 2005, Billy Graham was said to have preached in person to 210 million people.
Now, Russia's President Vladimir Putin has unveiled a new range of nuclear weapons, which he says could evade American missile defense shields and hit targets around the world. He said the arms, which include an underwater drone and a missile capable of traveling at 5 times the speed of sound, were either ready or being developed. He made the unexpected announcement during his State of the Nation speech ahead of Russia's presidential election later this month. From Moscow, Steve Rosenberg reports.
Vladimir Vladimirovich Putin.
He never slips into a room quietly. Vladimir Putin took the stage for his annual State of the Nation address. The audience was expecting to hear about the economy, social issues, and there was some of that. But then the Kremlin leader took everyone by surprise. On a video screen, he showcased the very latest Russian nuclear weapons, 200-ton intercontinental ballistic missiles, cruise missiles with nuclear engines. He claimed they could hit any target and dodge any defense. And there's more, he said. And the show continued. The missiles kept coming, and with them, a warning to the West. Those who tried to contain Russia have failed, President Putin said. Believe me, I am not bluffing.
I think we're entering, if not already in, a new Cold War. And that's not just because of Putin's statements this morning. You hear President Trump also thumping his chest and talking about having the best nuclear systems.
But in Moscow, the reaction from the whole, Russia is acting in self-defense.
It's reminiscent of the Cold War, is it not? We're talking about an arms race.
I don't believe, at least the statement from my president isn't the Cold War rhetoric. And if you are looking for the roots for the next edition of the Cold War, look to the West.
The Kremlin was delivering two messages today with this speech. The first message was to the West. Russia will not be pushed around. The second message, ahead of elections here, was to the people of Russia. Vote for Putin and you'll have security at home.
That's how the Kremlin wants Russians to see their president, as the embodiment of Russia, as the protector of their country. Steve Rosenberg, BBC News, Moscow.
You're watching Newsday on the BBC. Still to come on the program, we travel to the remote Indian state of Nagaland to meet the woman taking on the region's male-dominated political system.
Also coming up on the program,
the silent child.
A film about a profoundly deaf six-year-old that's making a big noise ahead of the Oscars.
Welcome back to Newsday on the BBC. I'm Marie Goy in Singapore.
And I'm Kasia Madeira in London. Our top stories. President Trump says that he'll impose steep import tariffs on steel and aluminium in a move that's likely to provoke a backlash from China.
Boko Haram strikes again, kidnapping more than 100 schoolgirls in Nigeria. They were taken 12 days ago in what the president describes as a national disaster. Well, let's take a look at some front pages from around the world, and let's start with the Japan Times, which reports that the South Korean president has revived the comfort women dispute after reaching a deal under the previous administration. Moon Jae-in has urged Tokyo to act on the basis of remorse and reconciliation, the paper says, and acknowledged that South Korean women were forced to provide sex for Japanese troops during the Second World War. Meanwhile, the China Daily reports that China is to continue offering economic and technological assistance to the Pacific Island nation of Tonga. President Xi Jinping says the country will do this without imposing political conditions, and he's pictured here with the King of Tonga, who's on a state visit to China. And finally, both the Bangkok Post and the Gulf News have a story about an assassination attempt on Queen Elizabeth. The Gulf News says official documents, which were published on Thursday, reveal for the first time that a teenager tried to fire a shot at the Queen when she visited New Zealand in 1981. So those are the papers. Kasia, what are the stories sparking discussions online?
Mariko, it's one story, one big story. The freezing weather has got people talking and complaining across Europe. Those icy blizzards are continuing to cause travel chaos. Winds from Siberia have brought the coldest temperatures to the continent for years. The cold snap's been given various nicknames. In Britain, we're calling it the Beast from the East. The Dutch are describing it as the Siberian Bear. And Sweden has gone for the Snow Cannon. But I tell you what, Mariko, whatever you call it, it is very, very cold. It is now 12 days since 110 schoolgirls in Dapchi, Nigeria, were kidnapped from their school by Boko Haram militants. Their fate remains unknown. Their parents are facing an agonizing wait for any news. It's already raising uncomfortable comparisons with the kidnap of 276 Nigerian girls from Chibok 4 years ago. The BBC's Stephanie Hegarty has visited the school in Dapchi to meet the families of some of those missing girls. Here's her report.
This is where Fatima ran when the militants attacked her school. It was 7 p.m. She was in her dorm with her best friend Zara. They were just about to eat their dinner when they heard gunshots.
One of our teachers told us to come out. When we came out, we saw bullets flying in the air like fire. There was confusion all over the school. Students screaming and rushing towards the gate. But the gate was locked.
This is the path that many of the girls took to try and get away. The main exit is down that way. And you can see some of their discarded sandals. They're littered all along this path here.
Then we saw the militants' trucks, and they were shooting and calling us to get into the trucks. They were pretending they would help us.
During the attack, Fatima managed to run away from the militants twice. But she was with her best friend Zara when they were attacked, and they got separated. She said altogether five of her closest friends are missing.
This is Zara. She's 14.
Her friend Fatima said business was her favorite subject.
Yes, business, the key.
Her sister Falmata is 25 and went to the same school as the girls. She was close to Zara. It was 3 days before the government admitted that there had been a kidnapping. Last week, the authorities claimed girls had been rescued. Then they said that claim was false. For Zara's mum, that was the hardest moment. Nigeria's president has said that the military and air force are searching for the girls. But parents aren't reassured.
In this school, there are no children of government officials. All the students are the daughters of poor people.
Now the school is eerily quiet. The scene is chillingly similar to the aftermath of the kidnapping of the Chibok schoolgirls in 2014. It was 3 years before most of those girls were released, and over 100 of them are still missing. The parents of Dapchi are afraid that they will also wait years to see their children again. Stephanie Hegarty, BBC News, Dapchi.
Now, will a woman finally create history in India's northeastern state of Nagaland by entering its elected assembly? Well, Rekha Rostogru is one of the only 5 women contestants for the upcoming elections. There are 60 seats in the assembly, and unlike most states in India, Nagaland has been granted a great degree of state autonomy. But Naga society is patriarchal, and customs and traditions don't allow women to enter politics. A BBC team traveled to the remote village to meet her and hear her story.
A man is cooking at home and we come and see that he's cooking. Oh my God, your husband cooks! You know, like that. We think that the husband is not supposed to cook. I have to break this barrier. I have to penetrate it and show that there is a way, that there is hope. When I see other states in India, women doing very well in politicians, we have chief ministers, we have president of political parties, I feel sad when I look back at Nagaland. Nagaland can also be one of them. The first general election in Nagaland was 1964, and today we are in 2018, and not a single woman is elected in the 60 house. And I think women can make a lot of difference because I see women has integrity. Women are hardworking, they're honest, and I know that they will get the job done. An outsider coming here, looking at Naga women, they will think that, okay, Naga are equal, you know, they're smart, they're enterprising. But when you actually live with them, then you will know that a lot of women are not allowed to decide. A lot of women are not allowed to make policy making. Women were happy that I'm contesting, but they were scared to encourage me because they know that at the end of the day, they have to listen to their husband. You know? Even today, I faced stiff opposition from male groups, especially leaders, because they think that women should not talk politics. They think that women cannot fight. But I feel they feel insecure. They feel threatened by women, you know, standing for election. We deserve more appreciation from men, from society. We want acceptance, actually. Me joining politics is not a fight between men and women. I'm asking them that together we can make a lot of difference.
Among the stars hoping for an Oscar this Sunday is Maisie Sly, a deaf 6-year-old, who has the lead role in the British drama The Silent Child, as Colin Patterson reports.
Hello, I'm Maisie. I'm in Hollywood for the Oscars.
It's a story so happy it could be the plot of a Hollywood film. Maisie Sly had never even acted before her parents were told about filmmakers looking for a profoundly deaf girl to star in their film, The Silent Child.
And now, here are the nominees for Best Live Action Short Film.
This is the moment in January when the team gathered to find out if they had been nominated for an Oscar.
My Nephew Emmett, The Silent Child.
Yes!
And so this week, they reunited at Heathrow.
Hello, welcome on board.
Thank you very much.
And headed to Los Angeles. Most people prepare for the Oscars by meeting stylists and planning acceptance speeches. Maisie's schedule has been rather different.
My favourite thing this week was Kids Place and the zoo. Yep, that's my favourite thing this week.
Welcome to Hollywood.
Although she is having to get used to people recognising her.
I saw her on television just last week. They say she's nominated.
Do you think she'll be able to get a job one day?
Yeah. Rachel Shenton wrote and stars in The Silent Child. She learned sign language after her own father lost his hearing.
The nomination means that ultimately now we're in over 600 cinemas in the US, which is huge for us as a short film, and really important for the subject, which is obviously deafness and shining a much needed light on access to education for deaf children.
There's Meryl Streep.
Her former Hollyoaks co-star Chris Overton directed the film, and at a lunch for all the nominees, they got to meet one of his heroes.
Steven Spielberg was in between me and Rachel, and
the person taking the photo said, oh, can we move, because the light's not good. So we were ordering Spielberg around.
It's an Oscar!
Now all that remains is to find out if there'll be a Hollywood happy ending. On Sunday night, Maisie could get her hands on a real one of these. Colin Patterson, BBC News, Los Angeles.
Maisie, good luck to everybody nominated. From Mariko, from me, thanks for watching Newsday. Bye-bye.